pause, reset, and reboot. Yes, the crisis that the world is facing today is unprecedented. It's colossal. That's the negative. What's the positive? The positive is that you and me have never had a larger window to devote purely to learning than we have today. And that's why EMA, the Event and Entertainment Management Association of India, is bringing to the event fraternity and audiences at large one initiative after the other to engage, entertain, inspire, motivate, and educate you. We are bringing to you thought leaders from across the expanse of India. We are bringing to you industry captains from within the Indian experiential industry, and we are bringing to you leading performing artists from across India. At 10 a.m., catch us on EMA Stay Fit. At 12:30, it's the Michael Menezes Knowledge Series. At 2 p.m., it's Future Ready Workshops. And at 4 p.m., it's the Future Ready Leadership Series. Remember, it's on the EMA official Facebook page.
Namaskar, dear EMA members.
I think it's a great idea of just putting himself out there.
Are you armed and ready for that race? Well, I'm learning. Are you?
Hello, everyone. I, Sanchali Arora, welcome you to the next episode of the webinar series, EMA Future Ready Workshops. As you're all aware, the EMA Future Ready Workshop is an initiative to foster learning useful trends in technology and resources, doing growth through collaborations in our industry, and of course, to put the best practices for business and joint initiatives. Now, let me start today's webinar by giving a tribute to the legend, the veteran, the man who was behind modern day pyrotechnics, late Sri Amir Morani ji, who left for his heavenly abode on the 24th of January, 2019. Now, friends, ladies and gentlemen, having said that, let me start today's session by giving you a short background as to what we will be talking about. Now, there are a few things more striking than the beautiful fireworks display. If you need to create visual drama and stunning scenes, pyrotechnic special effects are often the answer. Now, these displays produce brilliant effects to punctuate a particular part of a concert, to maybe launch products, maybe to welcome players onto a sports pitch, to produce high temperature, low debris sequences from maybe rooftops and a variety of other specific occasions. Now, the difference between fireworks and pyrotechnics is that pyro can be used in a much closer proximity to the public due to the more controlled nature of the product. Though controlled, to operate it is not a child's play. Pyrotechnics is in fact an area of expertise that requires the careful and correct calculation of the ever so important things like safety radius, fallout zone, so that one can gauge the largest size of the fireworks that can be used in an event venue. And of course, then there are other factors like city, country, state, where the event is being performed. Now joining us today and elaborating on SFX and pyro installation and safety is Azan Morani, Managing Director, Amir Morani Fireworks Private Limited, AMFW. AMFW, friends, is the pioneer and leading pyrotechnic display company in India with over decades of experience in fireworks display and special effects, serving its clients with customized displays ranging from small-scale indoor concerts to grand-scale remotely synchronized aerial displays and pyro musicals. Now, with the help of evolving technology, they have continued to develop and produce the largest and the most prestigious fireworks displays ranging from airline launches, glamorous royal weddings. They have executed this with personalized supervision, safety precautions in place, and with the use of the latest digital remote firing technology. Some of the events that we have heard of, we know, are the Justin Bieber Purpose World Tour, Global Citizen India Festival, Coldplay, 60th Anniversary of Japan-India Diplomatic Relations, and on and on. Well, moderating this session right here today is Raghav Roy Kapoor, founder, the Live Wire Experience. Let me hand over the session now to him to take it forward from here. Over to you, Raghav.
Thank you, Sanchali, for the warm welcome and introduction. Good to have you back on the show. Well, folks, as we slowly cover all aspects of events and event production, soft skills and other workshops relevant to all of us, I do hope people are enjoying the series by Imam. I think we've covered sound, light, video, power, structure and construct, networking, and a few others. Today we have a one of its kind, or rather very first time ever, SFX and PYRO workshop for you. Yes, this is an integral part of creating the wow moments for any event or experience today. And I think, you know, many of us will learn the best practices of using SFX and pyrotechnics in the world of live events. Our speaker today is a fourth generation entrepreneur, and the very essence of special effects, pyro, fireworks just runs in his blood. He lives to watch people in the awe of his work, and that's what brings him a smile to his face. Give it up for the Gen X of the Morani family, Azan Morani from Amir Morani Fireworks. Azan, nice to have you on the show today. You know, before we get started, I thought we could just catch up, chit chat a little bit for everyone's benefit. So tell me a little about you and how did you decide to take on the family legacy? What did you think of doing differently? And what is it that we see you bring to the table? I mean, the legacy you guys have had over almost 8 decades. You know, how are you going to do things differently and take it on? So let's get over to you, Azan.
Hello, guys. Hi, everybody. Thank you all for joining in. It's an honor to help and talk to you guys and answer any of your questions that you guys might have. To answer Raghav's question, I started and got into the field back in 2013. And my first show was in the United States in Boston. We had to go through an extensive training protocol over there, and basically be efficient and knowledgeable about pyrotechnics, about handling pyrotechnics, explosives, the different types of explosives, the different classifications, how you handle them, how you transport them, and so on and so forth. So back then, 2013, that's when it all started for me. My dad told me, I was talking to him one day on the phone, he's like, you better go and get trained on international levels because the future is there. So that's what drove me to do it. I did it. And after that, no looking back, 2016 is when he called me back to India to help him out with the business and basically expand and do whatever we can do with the given resources and technology. And yeah, and I'm going to put up a slide so you guys can see some of the accomplishments.
Fabulous, fabulous. I think the accolades you've got, and I think your vision for the organization taking it to the next level is absolutely commendable. We wish you all the very best. I think let's jump into your session and let's see what you have in store for us. Everyone's excited since we've never really done this on a platform like this. Friends, feel free to ask questions to the presentation like you always do. I will take as many of them as I can section-wise and request you to share them all in the Q&A box. So Azan, take it away, please.
So everybody, this is a brief of what we will be covering today. We'll start with an introduction, go on to talking about the different safety applications, what goes into planning it, what is required from the client's end, what are the technicalities that we have to face, the preparation, execution, some behind the scenes footage and setup, the different types of stuff, the technology that is now in place, and obviously the latest inventions that are there in the pyro world. So without further ado, let's go into some of the past displays that were done by my predecessors, my dad, his brothers, my brother, all the way down, fast forward to 2019. On this particular page, we just did a show in Vancouver representing India for the first time in any international fireworks competition ever. Gonna jump you right into this. So we all have heard the term special effects, fireworks. What are special effects? It's basically visual tricks, illusions created by equipment, devices, animations, props, which have the effects of confetti, flames, the color smoke, as you see in the picture here, confetti, smoke bubble. And the other type of special effects are optical effects, which it doesn't relate to our field as much, but it has to do with photography, visual, theatrics, and stuff like that. So this is an example of a CO2 effect. These are the two devices typically that we use in India that give this kind of an effect. So there are stationary applications to it. There are handheld applications to it. So they are used by a CO2 tank at the back. And everything over here is coming out through this pressurized hose, as you can see. Hold on one second. The next effect, streamers. These are basically two types of streamers. One come in flame-proof paper. There's metallic flame-proof streamers, all designed to give different effects and different feels for different themes of the events. All of these have to be taken and installed with great caution, because these do have pressurized tanks. Any leakage or any kind of malfunction in the equipment can potentially be dangerous to the stage, to the audience, to everybody around it. The next effect over is the new smoke bubble by Magic FX. They are usually the pioneers in inventing new SFX technology. They're very world renowned. They have their stuff together. And this is an effect that this basically derives from this particular machine. Moving on to confetti. As you can see here, the different machines and equipment that can give out these specific effects. As you can see on the picture on the right, the couple is walking in when their friends are using these confetti pistols to shoot out confetti in a very small, confined place, which does not permit us to use bigger, more heavier equipment and machinery. However, on the left, these are the effects of the stadium blowers and the stadium shot equipment, which is used to create the same effect. As we all know, we've seen it in all of the festivals with Sunburn, Supersonic, the flame machines, an incredible value add, an incredible adrenaline booster for the audience. These are multiple manufacturers around the globe make these machines. One of them is Magic FX, one of them is Explo Flames. These are some of the pictures from the multiple different equipment providers and their effects. And how you use it really comes down to personal preference. The newest technology in special effects is the sparkular, the spark effects, which basically uses chemicalized powder inside an equipment, and is controlled by DMX to let go and give different heights and durations of sparks for stage events, pyrotechnic entries, wedding entries, whatever the event might be. A picture of that equipment, a close up a little bit of it, is on the left for you guys to review.
So Azan, I'm going to come in here. Can we go back to the slide, the one before this? So does this typically, replace the conventional gerbs that we have? Is this what the product is?
Yes and no, because this actually requires a bunch of electricity, cabling, DMX. You have to be able, it comes down to say for a more synchronized show, a show that you have to script out. Mm-hmm. For the traditional gerbs can still be used. When there's a lack of console space, there's a lack of proper equipment handling, and you're just trying to do entries across a walkway or a pathway, then your regular gerbs serve the purpose.
Right. Yeah. But say for a stage show or a concert or a corporate event, where we know what the cues are, it's a large 60 plus foot stage. Can this replace it from a safer point of view as well?
Yes. Yes, absolutely. When you're doing stage shows, concerts, these devices claim to be absolutely burn-free, spark-free. They do not ignite a flame. They basically use chemicalized powder for the same effect. And you can use it multiple times without having a technician go out and replace it or change it out, which you cannot do in the regular.
Right, that was my next question. How many shots do you kind of get out of it if we're looking at maybe 10-second pops each?
So that you can break it down into 1 second pops. You want the 1 second pop to go for 1 meter, for 5 meters, for 3 meters, for 10 meters.
Okay.
You can change the duration of it as well. 1 second, 5 second, 10 second, 30 second. that comes down to how you plan your queues, your event. What is the purpose of using that effect?
Mm-hmm.
If it's a 1 second finale, you just go psst, and then it's done.
Right. And this would use the same power line as the other SFX that we're powering on the stage, or would this need a separate power line?
Correct. And that was going to be my next slide. I'll jump right on into it. So this is usually it's controlled by DMX as a switchback, as you can see up here on the top. Or if you choose to go with the non-DMX operation, you have effectivators for a single queue and for multiple queues here. Mm-hmm. So in particular, power supply lining item goes right into the back over there, and you can hit the desired effect by the corresponding key on the panel. And likewise, on the left side, if you see an example of a DMX controller, which you can use in scripting and choreographing and synchronizing for concerts and when international artists come down, or even domestic artists, if they have a fixed time-coded track or a performance that they have, it's very easy to integrate all these special effects and pyrotechnics using a device like this.
Fabulous.
And yep, this is your traditional gerbs. So you can see why the Sparkular machine or the Spark machine would not be beneficial in this particular scenario, because there wouldn't be any place for it to be stationed. You'd have to run a lot of wiring. Given the amounts of people standing right by this in this particular picture, that option just would not be feasible.
Now, while we talk about this product, you know, the conventional gerbs, I have to bring about the point of safety. You know, many incidents have happened with these gerbs, where things have caught fire or there have been sparks on the stage. What is the actual composition of this, and how does an agency, or how does an event manager, or how does a partner understand the quality of the product, really?
Correct. The chemical composition of pyrotechnics and fireworks, I'm going to come into that in my later slide, so I'll leave that question for there. But it comes down to the quality and the safety clearances that you use for the particular device. A lot of people in India call it cold pyros. There is no such thing as cold pyros. That's an oxymoron. Mm-hmm. Pyro can't be cold. It's the new technology with the spark machines. That is what they're going for. But if you put a piece of paper on any traditional gerb right when it's there and light it, it's going to catch fire. So even though the gerbs come into the close prox pyro category, they are still to be treated as explosives with fire, with gunpowder and other explosive chemicals. You have to either have a 15 feet clearance for them. If we usually try to keep all pyro away from people, even if it's on stage, we build an additional pyro pit, which again, I'll come back into when we hit the execution slide. Sure. I'll talk more about it over there.
Sure. On this subject, there's a question from Yogesh Malhotra. How about the timing of these conventional gerbs? As I've experienced in this latest show, that the 1 second gerbs, you know, they work perfectly fine when you're doing an EDM festival or something which is high intensity. It comes out and zoop, it's done. But typically when you're looking at a longer gerb, maybe a 10 second or a 30 second, it really takes a long time to come on and go into its full force. Is there any way we can avoid this? And also, is there any way by which sparks work with fine drops? I don't know what that means, but I guess the drops that are falling from that.
The drops as in, can you clarify the drops as in?
He's asked, is there any way by which this spark works with drops? I don't know, but if you can tell us a little bit about the timing and about the startup time.
Drops, I'm guessing it's that.
Yes.
The traditional job, you have pretty much no say in how they operate, because those are prepackaged. There's literally no control once you ignite it. Usually, you have the option of picking it right off the box, but again, the reliability of that is just not trusted. I think that is why these bigger companies like Magic FX and Sparkular and Chauvin have gone towards the electronic concept, where the user and the operator has a lot more control over what happens on stage. So you can time these spark effects to last for a second, as Yogesh requested, or if it's a longer one, you can go up to 5 seconds, 10 seconds, and you can also control the heights.
Right. Right. So I guess they were referring to the drops in the music, in the beat drops. Yeah. So typically how you want to time it for the when the drop comes and you fire it, when there's right.
I wouldn't recommend a job for that, for a music drop. I mean, that's usually the thing for a stage mine or a stage comet, but that comes down to user preference and rider technicalities. I'm going to move on to the next slide. All right. So what are fireworks? Fireworks are pretty much, it's basically a device, which is a chemical combination of oxidizers and metallic salts. As you can see to the picture to your right, the different elements when fused with different oxidizers and different chemicals provide different colors. And this all happens once there is ignition, which is required for the oxidizers to go and burn. And that produces different colors, different flames, the whistle effect, the titanium salute bangs, and so on and so forth. Pyrotechnics, on the other hand, is when you apply fine art and application to the to regular fireworks. And when you start scripting shows, or when everything that puts an electronic computerized factor would count as pyrotechnics. And obviously, these are all explosives at the end of the day, no matter what it is, have to be handled, transported, and stored with extreme caution and safety. And I'll get more into that, but general awareness when you're on site or when you're handling it, make sure nobody's smoking around you, make sure there's no garbage. That should be just regular norms throughout. There are two types of pyrotechnics, the traditional and close proximity. As you can see on the picture on the right, that's usually what we would go for as close proximity. The picture under that, you can see the red comets shooting up with the tail to it. And then right behind that, you can see golden shells. The golden shells are traditional, the red comets are close proximity. Now, mines and comets also come in different sizes. Some are not close proximity, some require their distances, and some designed for the stage don't require that much distance.
Right. You know, while we're talking about gerbs, there's a quick question from Rodney here. You know, the gerbs that you showed us, are they smoke-free gerbs? Or, because many a time, a lot of vocalists or artists or band members have a problem with the smell that you kind of get after that. So is there a solution to this?
No. Comes down to the quality of the product itself and who you're sourcing it from. If you're getting a quote from somebody for, say, $600, and you're getting a quote for somebody who, say, $300, that is a no-brainer that there would be a difference in quality. But again, the new spark systems is the future in that particular field, especially for stage events. It's safer, right, for sure.
Right.
And I would definitely encourage people to look into that concept and kind of explore it from there.
Excellent. Also, you know, you were talking about the CO2 jet some time back. It's a very common product we use. Are there any more interesting ways to use it than apart from the base of the stage? Also, is it safe to use it from the truss facing downwards? A question from Zisha.
Safety and application of the CO2 jets, I mean, you have to understand that they all come from a pressurized gas cylinder filled with CO2. So the pipe itself, the hose itself, has to be cleared of destruction, no coils in it, preferably. Keep it away from all sharp and pointable objects that can potentially pierce the hose itself, which can cause damage to your equipment, to the show. It can ruin everything all in one go. To answer Zishan's question about the truss, yes, with the appropriate truss clamps from the manufacturers and based on your quality and the resistance of your truss, if it's engineered and placed correctly and stabilized, no problem in using the CO2 jets mounted from the truss. Right. Absolutely.
So guys, please don't use binding wire or rope or try to kind of tie it on. That's not going to work. It's going to fall down and somebody's going to get hurt. It has to be attached to truss clamps.
Yeah, all special effects, the most popular ones, they have additional accessories that come with it for safety, for different types of applications, for truss, for mounting, for sideways mounting. The same goes for the switchbacks, which they want, if they have to keep it at a different location, which is far away from the console, then that you can do that as well. But truss clamps all the way, the safest way to go.
Couple of more questions on this. One is from Akash, that is colored smoke safe to breathe? And secondly, can CO2 cause suffocation in a closed space as well?
Yes and yes. Colored smoke, there are two types. One is the organic based colored smoke cylinders, which basically use pressurized air and organic holy colors, which are free from any chemicals that we can use at holy parties in one of my pictures that I showed.
Right.
The other aspect of the colored smoke is the pyrotechnic ignition of colored smoke, which has a basic pyrotechnic charge that is used to ignite the color coming out in flames, which most of the times you can has a really foul smell to it as well. And Raga, what was the other question?
Also about, is a CO2 jet used in a closed space, is it suffocating? Is it going to be a problem?
CO2, yes. Full form carbon dioxide. It's definitely harmful in enclosed spaces when installing a CO2 gun or CO2 jets for an event inside a ballroom, especially. A few things to know, to take account are the hall height, the amount of people you're expecting, and the quantity of the CO2 then pumped in. What are the AC levels of the banquet? Are they pumping in oxygen and AC throughout? Do they have cutoff times? All of that has to be cleared apart so that there is constant circulation of fresh air coming in and the CO2 that is being dispersed out of the equipment which is going out. Right. So yes, in short, it is dangerous if the correct steps and safety is not taken into account.
Another quick question from Kamal on the same subject. How long can the shot be, a CO2 jet? How long can we fire it? 5 seconds, 10 seconds, or can it be as long? Does it create too much pressure?
No, usually the correct way to do it is you can do it for a second, 3 seconds, up to 5 seconds. See, the thing is you are limited with your cylinder capacity.
Right.
Some cylinders are 30 kgs, some cylinders are 45 kgs. You have the option of spraying it all out in once as well, but then that would cause formation of ice around the tube, around the valves, which would basically, you would lose control over it, because if it's frozen in its open position, it's going to secrete all of that CO2 right out. Advisable to use it in 3 to 5 second gaps, not more.
Also, does altitude also make a difference? As a question from Parikshit, he used CO2 confettis and streamers in a hilly region, which is in a higher altitude. It didn't have as much pressure in it, but when they used the same equipment and they checked it once it came back to Bombay, it was working just fine. So is it heat, is it weather, or is it altitude?
Correct. Yes, humidity plays a heavy role. If it's outside burning hot and you have your CO2 over there and you're planning on shooting it, and it's just, you don't see the throw going as far at all. That's just because of the environmental factors. If you see the same thing, if you use it at a nighttime in a sangeet in a beautiful cool area, you're going to see white heavy smoke come out. That's just the environment, and there's not much you can do about it.
But what about the altitude in a hilly area?
I'm not sure. I can get back to you about that, but it has to do with pressure, but I don't want to comment on it. I'll look into that actually, because altitude in general should not make a difference. Temperature, yes, makes a difference.
Right, great.
Okay, I'm gonna move on to the next. So, like we discussed, there are two types of pyrotechnics, traditional and close proximity. And so the traditional pyrotechnics, they come in different sizes, and they're commonly referred to as shells. And if you look at the picture here on the right, you can see the different effects a traditional pyrotechnic shell can create, from a brocade to a willow to a chrysanthemum. And these are all its definitions and looks. I'm pretty sure everybody has seen all of these at some point in their life. And it's good to put a word to what you see. This is a picture of the shell on the left, which come in different sizes, like I mentioned in the previous slide. The picture next to it is the composition of stars, chemicals, and I have also given you a description and the mechanical building of a shell, the two types of shells, cylindrical shells and their spherical global ball type shells. I'll give you all a second to kind of read this and kind of familiarize yourself with the terminology, because we're going to be using these a lot. And on the bottom left is usually what there's the types of close prox pyrotechnics. If you see something like that on stage or near your stage, you're most likely to be fine.
Right. You know, two other questions coming in. How important is the wind factor? Question from Vinayak Talwar. While using any of these effects, you know, just before the ignition, if there's uncertain wind, we can't do the test shot. What is there any sort of solution to it when we're using streamers or confettis or CO2?
With CO2, you can still do a test shot. With confetti, you can still do a test shot. With pyrotechnics, you absolutely cannot do a test shot because right. the wind absolutely determines the nature and how your show is going to look. Right. If there's a heavy wind, if your pyrotechnics are placed in a garden, right, say about 500 meters in front of you, and there's a strong headwind coming towards you, you might consider talking to the event manager and the queue flow manager to push your timeline a little bit so that you get the best advantage when the wind has died down or the wind is blowing away from you.
Right, right. Absolutely. You know, also, you know, a lot of people want to know, including me, how long does a 30 or a 45 kg tank for CO2 typically last? How many shots can you do? Because, and also, is there any way to check how much material is left in the tank? Because, you know, many times you're waiting and there's a queue and the guy says, oh, we kind of run out sort of a thing because you end up using so much. So is there any way to real time monitor the pressure?
In real time, there is no way to manage because we don't even have the tanks which have the gauges on them in India. Some countries overseas, they usually connect their tanks with a type of gauge which dials in the pressure of the tank. So you already know if that's a full tank, a half tank, a quarter tank. A 30 kg, 45 kg tank, again, comes down to usage. Usually, if you keep it all pressed at one time, a 30 kg tank would be gone in 30 seconds or 15 right. seconds. It just comes down to your output, the different types of CO2 machines. There's a power jet, which requires four cylinders as opposed to one, but your output is almost double.
Right, thanks.
Okay, I'm going to move on to the next. I hope that slide with the shell manufacturing composition and thing is useful, I hope.
Yeah, I think it's a little unclear to people. It's a little pixelating, but you can quickly run us through it.
Right, okay. So as you guys see at the bottom of the sphere where there's a rectangular tube coming down right all the way to the bottom, that's where the lift charge is settled in. And the lift charge is basically just a lot of black powder and it's confined and it's restricted in a place that will basically, it's so pressurized that it is responsible for giving the shell its optimum height. So if this, the second you see that little wick going from the lift charge up into the round circular ball, that is the time fuse delay. So from the launch till it's traveled to its optimum height, 200, 300 feet, whatever the designation is, that time fuse delay does its job in not allowing the shell to burst right at ignition. And right in the shell, you'd see those little ball looking structures. Those are your multiple effects, stars, colors, bangs, whatever it is that your shell is designed, whatever the function is designed to do. There are multiple, again, types of shells that can go up into one launch, open up, and then open up into more shells. Those are called shells of shells. And different effects, different shells have different types of colors and functions.
Right. You know, there's another quick question coming from Rodney about the tanks. You know, generally it takes some time to change the CO2 tanks. Is there any sort of a solution where we can loop in the next tank already so we don't lose our queue? See, I think a lot of us event managers use CO2 and gerbs majorly for a lot of our work, you know, so I think there are a lot of relevant questions coming in there.
Right. There are usually connectors that are available for purchase where you can connect one single CO2 jet to four additional tanks without any kind of issue. And those tanks should be able to suffice throughout your entire duration of your show. It comes down to which planner you're using for that. But those options are available where if you do not want any technicians going out into the field to change any of the tanks or the CO2 connections, yes, that is available. You have extension ports available on putting on multiple tanks.
Also, another thing I personally face is the distance of the tanks from the nozzle. Is there a particular guideline for that? Because generally the vendors don't want to keep the tanks very far from the nozzles. Is there a particular thumb rule?
By nozzle, do you mean the actual CO2?
The jet, yes.
Okay. Usually it comes down to the length of wire. Up to 25-50 meters, there's usually no problem.
Oh, okay.
As long as it's a single track field, no loops, no cuts, your wire, your hose, your CO2 high pressure hose has to be completely in line. And that's usually why it is probably that they want to keep the tank right here and the jet right here. So there is a direct particular hose direction, and there's no coils and loops which can affect the pressure and output of the CO2.
Right. Excellent. You know, while we're talking about streamer jets, a quick question has come in about the streamer shots. Many a time they go up and get stuck on the truss. You know, we've got lighting on the truss, there are park ends. A, it gets stuck in something. B, what sort of quality is the paper? Is it going to catch fire? Is it something that is heat resistant? Can you throw a little light on this and how we can avoid the situation?
Okay. If it gets stuck in the truss, I mean, we usually have that problem every New Year's, and Shailesh is witness to that. It's just that you have to either change your positioning of it, or if you have a problem with it attacking your truss, or if you think your light fixtures, your moving lights, or your moving heads are going to, you have to cut it. That's the only way, because the effect itself cannot be changed. I mean, there's nothing you can do. You can maybe use the same stadium shot equipment to load confetti in and then shoot it, so that way nothing is getting stuck anywhere. Mm-hmm. But no, except changing the placement, there's really nothing you can do in preventing it from getting stuck in the truss.
No, more than stuck, is it likely to catch fire with the heat? Maybe if you have conventional lights like park ends?
Coming to that, there are three types of paper. There is traditional paper, which is not flameproof and heatproof. Mm-hmm. Then there is heatproof paper, and then there is water-soluble streamers, which is what we, and biodegradable, which I think is a very new, very nice invention where anything that you see, you just spray water on it, regular water, on a confetti or a streamer, when it's made a mess, and it's instantly dissolved. So the mess is gone.
That's fantastic.
And I think in people who love the environment and environmentalists, we're going to eat that up all the way. People who have a lot of eco-friendly weddings, they enjoy it because it's literally rice paper, and as soon as it hits water, it dissolves.
Is your company stocking and using these products?
Yeah, we have it. I think it's a good invention, and people should use it, especially for cleanup, because I feel like once you're done with your site, you have to give it back the way you got it.
Absolutely.
That's just a regular sense. I'm going to move back to the presentation. Is everybody good on this? I hope everybody has an understanding of how this works. And I'm available for more questions, obviously. But let's move on. So this is one of the bigger guns that we use. It's 24-inch. This picture is in Japan when we were there for a convention. If you look at the size of that motor, I could fit in that plus another one of me. And that is that massive. And securing that is very important. You cannot, it's just not anybody and everybody should be handling explosives like that in that particular thing. If you look at the picture in the middle, we've taken those big guns and buried them in sand and made a big massive sandbox as per se for the safety of explosion. Because God forbid, if that particular shell decides not to make its optimum height, it could take that entire barge out as we see it.
Wow, that's mammoth. You know, before you move on, there's a really nice question from Sandeep. Is there a limitation on the number of cylinders which can be used during live concerts, especially from the fire authorities, because it would be highly inflammable? So is there any sort of restriction to the number of cylinders that can be used?
The cylinders are highly flammable. I didn't catch that.
The CO2 cylinders, are they highly inflammable?
The best function of a CO2 jet or a CO2 device is that it is basically a fire extinguisher.
Right.
Properties of the CO2 tank and the contents of it, they're not flammable, but obviously they are very dangerous if the valve is damaged, or if it falls on a valve, or if it's not
exactly
handled.
So in context to that, is there a restriction on the number of cylinders you can use at a venue or a show by the government?
I don't recall, and maybe if there is, I'm not aware of it. And I can so before Justin Bieber, we had 98 cylinders at DYP.
Wow.
That was no problem. It worked on. It was a headache transporting them in, but other than that, it was great. We had no problem at all.
Right. You know, talking about comets and mines, there's a question from Saurabh Patil. A lot of different variants and color combinations of comets and mines are asked for by international EDM artists and their riders. Most combinations of colors are not available in India, and importing them is not permitted as per the import laws. Can we look at producing them locally, and will they be safe if you want specific colors of mines?
That is something that we as a company are looking into right now, of how can these be manufactured here without using the banned chemicals that the government of India is particularly... If you look at the two chemical compositions of chlorate and perchlorate, that is what is usually banned in India, and that is why the government is against importation of products. But there are two ways to go about this. We can either lobby as an event industry and to allow import of these new developed products, because these products are technically very nice. They're low smoke, they have no debris, they have no fallout. You can be as close to 3 meters from a pyrotechnic close prox device and be totally fine. But it's just that it's just not readily available in India. And that's something that we want to look into from a lobbying and import standpoint and from a manufacturing standpoint, where is there any other alternative to the chemicals that are used that are available and legal in India to basically produce the same effects.
Great.
Okay, I'll move on. So this is an example of all the fireworks turned pyrotechnics synchronized in a particular manner to get a desired effect in the sky. This is a picture still from our show in Vancouver this past July. We were representing India as the first company to do any international pyrotechnic competition. A few pictures from the same show, as you can see, we had about close to 500,000 people come up for our show. It was a very proud moment for us. And we plan to go back again. Let's see. Hopefully this corona really goes away quickly.
Since you're on the subject of fireworks, Azan, you know, is there any way we can visualize these, you know, before actually testing them out? So if we're pitching to a client or if we're doing something, this is a question from Parikshit. Is there a possibility we can visualize the shots digitally? Or, I mean, the only way to do it is a test run. So say we're pitching to a client and we want to make a presentation to them. Is there a way to do it digitally?
Absolutely. This is actually a good time for you to run the video.
Yeah,
I'll run it. Hold on 1 second. The question is absolutely, so all big shows, future pitches, that is the best way to do it, because the client can actually see what he's getting. Let me just see if I can pull this up for you really quickly. Okay, there you go. Why can't I see this? Okay. So if you go to see for Parikshit, this is how we actually, so this is the Bandra Worli C-Link. This is when pitching phases, when we decided to do a show. So if you look at this, this is a computer generated program and it allows us to visualize fireworks and the effects. And this is the basic, you know what I'm saying? And whatever it is that you need, that is an example of that.
So what is the software? What's the technology? Is it CG? Is it VFX? Yes. What exactly are you using here?
It is computer generated effects, okay. Which also basically integrates well. If you have a visual representation of what you wish to accomplish, mm-hmm. It's very easy to put that into reality and into the ground. Again, these are all subject to you following your safety clearances for each and every single device.
Right.
And I'm going to touch on that particular point, and I'm going to share the different clearances required for the different sizes so that everybody has somewhat of a basic understanding in this world of how to take the necessary precautions.
Sure. So for my peers out here, can I say that if there's a pitch somebody is doing, if there's a large project they're pitching for and it involves a lot of firework displays, can they team up with you and do a joint pitch to kind of get the ball rolling?
I am always open to collaboration. I love working with talent. I love working with people. And I believe that it's, you always can end up learning from the other person, no matter who it is.
Right. So as a lot of people are asking, what is the name of the software, guys? There's no name of the software. As he said, it's computer graphics that they're using. They're different softwares, and he'd be happy to connect with you on this. Also, another question, can we create a brand logo for any launch of a particular brand or an opening ceremony with fireworks?
I'm going to show you a video for that as well.
Fabulous.
One second. Guys, just bear with me for 1 second. Okay, so this is, I created this sim for a Republic Day show that never materialized. But this is essentially the newest technology. Using comets to basically put letters and symbols in the sky. And you go to see, you can actually even write names with it. And that comes down to accurate placement and basically understanding the products that you have at hand to create multiple things. And with the actual more complex logos, the future for doing that in the sky is through drones, through light drones.
Right.
That later on because
talking about this product again, what you showed us again is computer generated graphics, but how effective would it be in the real sense?
It's almost exact.
Okay almost so exact. the spacing and the proportions would be similar.
It's designed to look exactly like that in the show.
Right.
And now when you move towards to, okay, you know what, actually I can show it to you right now, hold on 1 second. I'm going to compare a simulation that I created for a show, mm-hmm. and the actual show, so that you guys can see the difference in how that works.
Right. So typically, would you have to do a pre-test for something like this, that we're creating a logo or something in the sky? Would you typically want to do a pre-test for something like this? Or you think you can rely completely on the software and it's going to be bang on?
The software that we use is pretty reliable. But again, the software doesn't know your products. You have to tell your products to the software. You have to design each and every effect. It's basically using Illustrator or something like that and be like, okay, I want this to look like that. So I'm gonna run a presentation for—
Sure, there's some more questions coming in to this logo part. You know, what would be the duration typically these logos would be up in the sky like you just showed us?
Exactly what you saw in the video. It usually just disappears in about 3 seconds. Because if you look at it, I'm pretty sure all of the attendees are familiar. These are basically comets. A comet does not last more than 2 seconds in the sky. And what you saw was a cluster of comets in a very organized manner to produce a specific effect. A
lot of questions coming in on this. Do you want to take a minute to tell us a little more about the process of planning it? What do you need from us event managers to plan it? What files
do
you need?
That's actually one of my few next slides.
Okay, super.
But I do want to show a concept of render to reality. So basically what a client, we can show a client and what the client is actually getting.
Great.
Wait, my share screen. So I'm going to run only the first few seconds of it. So that is a simulation, and I'm going to show you the actual footage of that as well. 1 second.
So guys, that was the pre-planning which Azan had done with his team. And now we're going to show us the actual footage of the video.
Give me 1 second, guys.
Tushar has a question. Any preferred weather conditions for logo SFX? Tushar, I think A, it shouldn't be raining for sure. B, I think it should be a clear sky. And typically,
and no wind, because these comets are very light.
Right.
It'll move immediately with the wind. Right. But let me show you the actual finish of that video. So this is the actual video. If you can see what was generated on the computer screen and what is generated in reality is the same.
Wow. So do you typically also need the dimensions of a space?
Oh, everything. I'm going to get to that in the planning.
Yeah, there are a lot of questions about the planning phase of this, so it'll be really helpful.
Yes, I'll just move on to that.
You see, we event managers are very inquisitive people, and we want to kind of know our subject matter before we go and sell something.
Happy to share anything that I can. It'll help all of us. Hold on, I'm going to move back to the PowerPoint for that. So, again, I think we've already gone over this, about the closed procs. Let's get to the planning stage. This is a picture at TY Patil when we were doing Biba. A note before we proceed and before we get into the handling of pyrotechnics and fireworks and special effects, one must know that electrical equipment, batteries, or anything that's open with an electrical power source should not be allowed anywhere near pyrotechnics which have been matched and fused. Firefighting equipment has to be always at hand, available, functional. It has to work. It shouldn't be expired. Smoking is prohibited on any fireworks site. You can create a designated shelter, minimum 75 feet away from the setup, and smoke over there if you have to. Exit out of any venue or fireworks location has to be very clearly marked for the workers and the people working, so that in case of any mishap, there's an fast way, an easy way of getting out. You, if God forbid a mishap happens, you don't have much time anyway. So there can be no confusion when it comes to safety of egress. And obviously you should be wearing your PPE, your glasses, your hard hats. If you're working on trusses, you have to have a harness above 6 feet, all of that good stuff, which should be standard practice in no matter the field you're in. This is an application of the pyrotechnics in weddings.
Right. So the idea is, Azan, there are different types of events we have nowadays. Can you tell us a little bit about the treatment of pyrotechnics and SFX, for different palettes? So for different types of events, what are the key things that you would take care of if you're doing a wedding compared to a sporting event, vice versa? What should be the points of concern? What should be the focal points while planning these things? If you can just give us a little bit on this, would be fab.
So usually what it all comes down to for any of these, for the weddings, the concerts, the sporting events, is basically your client brief. It comes down to what the client is expecting, what the client wants, what their budget is, and based on that, you can determine what you have to bring to the site, and then the handling of that particular device comes in. What was the other question, Raghav?
Well, can you just tell us a little bit about, the different palettes? For example, in a wedding, you don't want to use confetti or streamers if the dining tables or the round tables where people are eating dinner is very close by, so things like that. So if you can just quickly run us through what are the key things of each different type of event and how we should handle them. I know it's a little generic.
I don't know how to tag this one. With concerts, you have to be mindful, I guess, of your wiring, of your cabling. It all has to be in wire shoulders, going under, away from all audiences, down the FOH, down the center path, and to your respective equipment and machines. You have to be in contact with all the other operators, especially doing light, sound, SFX, fireworks. And the best way that we started doing this, we do is time code. We have one central commuting thing which has the music and everything embedded into it. Your lights are synchronized to it, your fireworks are synchronized to it, your special effects are synchronized to it, and whatever any other additional factors that you want to put in are synchronized to that. And that is how I think major, we use that for Coldplay, we use that for Bieber. We literally did nothing backstage.
Is this time code system to pre-program, and how much data do you actually need from the event managers? You need the complete data of the entire show flow?
Yes. Planning, you have to know every second of your show. Every second of your show is scripted. If you using time code, you are minimizing all potential room for error. A light stop functioning. Your pyro is not going to go off. You missed a cue. All of that is eliminated right off the bat.
So the synchronization is bang on. You're saying
it's frequency shift keying. It is. This technology hasn't evolved in 50 years. So they've done something, they got it right the first time, you know. And this information can be transmitted to multiple devices using a hardline XLR wire or two-way FSK radios that supported, like the GP Motorola GP328s are the best. So if I'm sitting in Goregaon, I can shoot a display on the heli without even having to be there. Wow. It's that reliable. Mm-hmm.
Right, so there are a lot of questions on budgets and Chinese equipment. I'm not really going to take these questions right now, gentlemen. Y'all can connect with Azan separately to understand budgets and the equipment. You know, is there any good console? Can you suggest, is Fire One the best console to use, or can you suggest anything better? Question from Saurabh Patil, since we're talking about operations.
There's no such thing as best console. Fire One, it's very advanced, but there it comes down to personal preference. It comes down to what a particular user himself, what his company are used to, what they can manage. If you're trying to go into a wireless operation, Fire One is great, but it gets very expensive to use Fire One. Galaxus is one of the best wireless firework systems there is. Then for smaller shows, you have Cobra, which I'm sure a lot of people in India have as well. Fire One is also very popular in India. Galaxus This is popular in India. It comes down to personal preference. It comes down to what you feel comfortable coding with, programming with. Can you, whatever you plan to achieve, can you achieve it? It comes down literally on what your compatibility with the software is.
So guys, very similar to sound or light. It totally depends what consoles you want to use, what you're comfortable in, what the application is. A quick question from Siddesh. Can we customize the sequence and colors of fireworks, flame, CO2, smoke, confetti shots, and ribbon shots? Can they be customized and sequenced?
I don't understand that. I mean, when it comes to, according to brand logo, your brand logo can be printed on the confetti, on the streamers. Obviously, you can't do anything with smoke because it's smoke. Flames itself also, you can't really put logos and writings on them. The only term where you can write stuff with is the comet shooting that I showed you. And when you have drones in the sky with lights, then I can create a particular logo or name.
Right. Very technical question from Victor. What's the best brand or quality of a hose for CO2 in India? Do you have an answer for that?
We don't source any of our hoses from India. I'm sure there are plenty, but all of our special effects are sourced from Magic Effects. They are the industry leaders. They are on the expensive side, but their quality is basically unmatched.
Right. Are we going to talk about the show running and queues here, or are we going to take that a little ahead?
Yeah, we can take that a little ahead. I want to jump in into the planning part of it.
Right. So guys, we're just going to talk about the planning right now, which, you know, I specifically sat with Azan and we curated this part because it's very important as event managers, how we share our plans with our sound, light, truss, and other tech setups. It's very important we also share our plans with our Pyro partners, you know, or the company who's doing our SFX, because I think that's when you can get, you know, a bang for the buck and also have the planning bang on in terms of what your show is going to entail. So over to you, Azan.
For any site, when you're doing a site selection, or if you're called to do a recce, or you're called by a client, be like, I want to do a stadium show, or I want to do a wedding show or a concert. The first thing you need right off the bat is the exact venue, you know, and if you look at the picture on the right, I don't know if it's clear or not, but you shortlist a venue and then you work a reversal from there. So in that picture, the audience is right by Taj, which is Colaba, and then this is literally a barge in the ocean carrying the larger 150 millimeter shells, which is the 6-inch diameter shells. Now the fallout for that particular, I'll get into more of this later on, so don't worry about noting all of this right down. I'll give you a proper chart. But an example of this is that this particular product, the largest product on that barge requires a 150 millimeter distance from anything valuable, or from people, from audiences, from structures, from buildings. That's very important in shortlisting your site. That's the reason why you have to do a recce. You get to site, you have to, you look around. Are there any gas stations, any petrol pumps, any dry grass, anything that's flammable that can cause an issue at showtime or even pre-showtime has to be identified and discussed with your client right off the bat, be it a client or an event manager. The earlier we are brought into the planning process, the more space there is for creativity. If there's a show on the 20th, you wake up on the 18th and tell me I need a fireworks show, you're going to get what's already there. You're not going to get anything new. So we pride ourselves on customizing every single show to its venue, to the client, to the theme, and creating and getting something extraordinary out of the experience that we planned on delivering to the audience. You know, and that a lot of venues will automatically scratch off the products that you can use based on those safety protocols, clearances, and establishments. So it's very a recce, and to be involved in the planning stage is imperative. It gives not only the fireworks provider a better edge, it gives the client, the event manager, a lot more options. You can get creative, you can start doing stuff that has not been done, you can have incorporate new designs, and I just think it's very, very beneficial for that.
You know, so talking about that, Azan, what is the turnaround time for readily available products versus customized solutions like you just spoke of? Questions?
If you're going down to them, if specific products have to be manufactured, they could take anywhere from 6 months to a year because of the seasonal climate in Sivakasi down south. There's only a limited time when we can actually manufacture products. And if the bookings and orders are not there on that time, there's not much you can do. That's why we stress and benefit that if it's a big show, if it's a memorable show, come to us in advance so we can actually go over multiple versions of the show with you. We can play with multiple soundtracks, play with multiple devices, multiple products, and you can literally have three versions of the sky in front of you and then you get to pick one. But when that timeline is not adhered, then you're stuck with what you get. And a request is when we are called, the more transparency we have in terms of locations, the more flexibility for use of locations and openness to creativity, it benefits the event that much more.
Right. And you spoke about the safety guidelines for aerial shots right now. Can you also throw some light on the safety guidelines for stage mines and comets, which are very close to the audience? Is there a thumb rule to follow?
Usually the device itself has it written on it. Okay, what is the safety distance? But rule of thumb, what I feel comfortable with is minimum 15 meters from anything. That comes down to a label that says 5 meters on the label and I'm using 15 meters because that's just the extra precaution we take. We shouldn't be mounting anything on stage at all. They should be in pyro pits, in black boxes, which are sprayed with fire retardant, which are basically wood boxes or metal sheets at the bottom. Anything that can stop the conducting of fire or extinguish it right there.
Right.
And coming back to this, I'm seeing most artists that they come down, they have their own tech riders. Coldplay has his. Bieber has his. When people come down for sunburn, they have their own. So there's not much that goes into the requirement for concerts and stuff like that. But when it comes to creativity for sporting events, for weddings, there's no tech writer for that, right? That has to come down from the individual agency or if there's a concept by the event planner, that has to be put into reality. And that's, again, coming down, planning, pre-planning recce is the primary reason the primary important thing to do for that. I want to kind of touch more on crew and operations. I know you guys have been waiting to figure out how everything is set up. And Raghav, are there any questions at this point or can I proceed?
There are some questions. Basically, again, people are talking about customization. How many days would customization and designing or number of days required for installation on site for the logos, et cetera, that you showed us?
Like I told you, for the logo itself, That's not hard to do. Maybe 24 hours to get that over to you. But right. Again, That's just the concept. The actual installation can take up to 3 days. And that's installation 3 days being on site. You know, it does not include for travel time. It does not include for transport time. It does not include any of that.
You know, also, since we're talking about time codes, there's a question from Shubham. Can we alter the time code during the show? I think this is something especially for weddings or corporate events. So when it comes to Coldplay or Justin Bieber, everything's running bang on. But when it comes to corporate event, there could be delays, there could be snags, there could be things which change, the scripting changes last minute. So can we really alter the time code, in real time?
Yeah, you literally, the time code is essentially a FM broadcaster, which has a play and pause button. So if for live events, if the queue flow has song, MC, talk, small demo, and then music again, or to the next event again, you literally, when the MC is talking, you just hit pause, and that's it, you're done. And to resume with your event flow, you just hit play. And then literally you have to do nothing else to your lights, sound, everything, just automatically in sync, your lights move as per the coded script. And yeah, it's really easy that way.
Okay, there's a not a question, but a statement from my friend Vincent Samuel, who's a heavy duty production guy in India in the last 25 years. He's a legend when it comes to all the top-notch productions. He says, while we speak about safety, till today, I've never in all my years seen a single fireworks agency speak directly to the fire engine team or the fire marshal, basically running them through what the setup is. It's always been the event manager in the line of fire. Safety is best spoken by the creators of the pyro materials, as they know the in-depth of the fire hazard. You know, this should definitely change. And I totally agree with him. When people come around for a review, or the cops come, or the fire guys come a day prior, or the morning of the show, you know, the agencies are always put forth. And I think what he means to say is we need a lot of people to be like partners to us. And I think Azan should start. And, since he's a Gen X of this family. So that's a statement from Vincent Samuel.
To address Vincent, you haven't worked with me yet, because I personally get into that. When the fire tender, I am insistent. And a lot of the event managers can call me a pain in the butt for that. But I don't move till there's a fire tender on site. And I've given him the brief of what to do in case, God forbid, something goes wrong. Even, for example, for Coldplay with Whiskraft, I had to go to the fire station, give them a written statement and take accountability of everything that was going to go down pyrotechnics-wise for that particular event. And even then, till the last minute, till Coldplay showed up, did not have permission to do the fireworks. And then last minute, the authorities agreed. They took a written consent from all of us saying that if anything goes wrong, you're individually going to be responsible. And all of that has to be really actually taking into account when it comes to fire safety. As much as it is our prerogative to brief the fire tenders and fire marshals about it, it comes down to the responsibility of the event managers to make sure that the event is clean, tidy, free of garbage. Because plastic, thermocol, your tents, your kapadas, anything that's shoved under the stage or in places are huge fire hazards. They have to be taken off-site completely, because those are the reasons why fires start, why there are mishaps. Not because of the ignition of the shell. A lot of fires happen because there's a short circuiting in lighting power. It's not always pyro that has to be blamed for fires that happen. Short circuits can happen anywhere, and garbage and waste and flammable materials around and inside site are very, very crucial in this.
I absolutely agree, and I think all of us have actually woken up only after the Make in India hazard that happened. Before that, the vendors used to come, do whatever they wanted and walk off, but I think we've all woken up for that, unfortunately. You know, a quick question from Sadesh. Normally in a corporate event, we place the cold pyros in the corner or the edge of the stage. We place the confetti shots on the ground near the stage. Is that the right position? Are there any safety hazards there? Is there a thumb rule to follow and execute it in a safer way in terms of space?
To answer Siddhesh's question, you place your gerbs. I do not use the word cold pyros because
they're not cold.
I don't like that term. The gerbs in the corner of the stage, yes. As long as you have some platform under it, you've sprayed fire retardant on the entire stage. and make sure there's no wind, because if you spray the front of the stage, your gerbs are running and there's wind going inside the stage, your sparks are going to fly in, which is, again, a fire hazard. You try and avoid that. Your confetti ground near stage, it comes down to what confetti are you using. Are you using confetti shot from pressurized air containers or cannons, or are you using confetti shots which are gunpowder based? Because both of them have different applications. Gunpowder based confetti, you need to go further away, and it's has a terrible smell. So anybody on stage for who you're firing the effect of is going to want to kill you after that.
Right. You know, a quick question from Pratesh, and we'll move forward. Do we collaborate with the local fire department for huge kind of events? So basically, I think what we're trying to understand here, Azan, is that when do we go and tell the fire department at what extent or what scale of show that, hey, this is what we're doing and come take a look or don't take a look or whatever you need to do?
So that comes down to as soon as we are basically commissioned to do the show, because as you are aware, and a very common problem that we face in our industry is budgets, confirmations, and advances. We don't get that. So how are we supposed to do anything? It comes down to when you are commissioning somebody, you've given them an advance and you've told them, yeah, this is your show. You have to kind of like be the liaison between that of it happening. I understand that it's us to bring the fire tender, but as an event for a concert, it's not the sole responsibility of the fireworks vendor to bring the fire firefighting equipment. It has to be the event management that does that, because the fire tender and firefighting equipment has to be on site at an event, regardless of fireworks, special effects, or lights or sound. That's just personal safety.
There are two things, Azan, over here, which I want to kind of debate out here. One is, it may be in a small event of 150 people with round table seating, but it may have a whole lot of SFX and fireworks and pyro. It doesn't necessarily, scale doesn't necessarily mean only if it's a large concert. So when do we actually wake up and smell the coffee, or when do we actually, what's the guideline that we should actually go down and do this? Would a company like yours consult us that, hey, I think we should need a fire tender in this case? Because look, we event managers are sandwiched, man, from all sides. We are kind of, we bear the brunt of it all. We, you know, and all fingers always pointing at us. So we need people like you to consult us and, okay, I think we're going beyond, maybe there's too much pyro, there's too much aerial. I think you guys should go and get a fire tender apart from just extinguisher. So can you throw a little more light on this?
No, for the fire tender part of it, I mean, even if your show is as small as 10 aerials, you should have firefighting equipment for it. Equipment like a fire extinguisher by itself is not sufficient at all. I mean, you can probably put out small thermocols or something on the floor, or like short circuits and stuff like that. But a fire extinguisher is going to do no good to you if a pyrotechnic explosion or fire breaks out, because the scale, the level is way higher. So our technical, our contractual details, our execution contracts have a steady clause that says firefighting equipment has to be at site from the first day of setup.
Like, sure.
It's in our, by God's grace, we haven't used it ever, but it doesn't hurt to have that option and safety. That has to be a prerequisite to everything.
Oh, absolutely. Rather be safe than sorry. Quick one from Karthik. What particular type of, there are different types and different labels of fire extinguishers. So any particular type that we should use for pyros? What works well?
There are water-based fire extinguishers. There are CO2-based extinguishers. Both of them are good. Both of them serve different functions. One's lighter than the other. One has a longer life than the other. It comes down to what you want to study and what your application of it is.
So I think I'll answer that as well. As event managers, ABC is what we use, since it covers all different types of fires as well. You know, a quick question from Pratik. What if there's a drizzle or slight rain, you know, in different climates all through the country? What are the pros and cons to carry on with the show? Will the pyros work, not work? How safe is it after that to carry on?
So we fired through rain before, but it gets dangerous when you have thunderstorms, T-storms, anything that has an electrical component to it. Because at the end of the day, your pyrotechnics can feel all wired to electronics, and all they need is 30 milliseconds of half an amp to ignite it. Which means if you're not using a good controlled firing system, if you're just using your regular wires, as you see, like the flexible wire, the two wire, 1.5 running into all your pyros, and if a lightning strike hits your wire, all the jobs are going to go off. And that's something that you have to take into account, you have to start. So shunting of the wire is very important when you're not using the product. The two wires the end of it of the match is inside the product. The two wires that are outside, and everybody in technical terms knows what I'm talking about. If you shunt that wire and keep it like that, you close out the electrical circuit, which means that if there is a lightning strike or any current or electricity passing through that particular device, it's not going to ignite because the circuit is closed.
Nice. So that's a quick pro tip from Azan. And Azan, I'll let you carry on with your presentation. The clock is ticking here with us.
Yeah. Second. So this is a picture of behind the scenes of our barge in Vancouver, and members of our crew working on designing the single shots, the mines and comets on specific racks, as you can see. These are the picture on the right, as you can see, are fiberglass motors and racks buried in the sand because these are big hitters. They create mass explosion. The sand kind of basically keeps the position motor at its designated angle and for a particular design to be implemented. Picture in the middle is the single shot racks that we use, which mount the different mines or comets at different particular angles, designing on how you want to play with it. Picture on the left is the OG and a pyro pit from Coldplay. This is what we had to do as per the fire regulation norms by the BMC and the fire department, that when they came and inspected, we had a trial round for that, and they said, not okay. We have to build a pyro pit and keep it completely away from the stage.
So that's what we had. So just a quick question, how far was the audience from this pyro pit?
About 40 feet.
About 40 feet, right, great. So that's almost about 12 and a half, 13 meters. Yeah. Quick question from Dharmendra. Dharmendra, yes, what Azan is talking about is on a boat, on a barge. And yes, he has put sand on the surface. Quickly tell us, how is the surface very badly affected when you're firing aerial shots?
No, they're not. These are...
the surface?
It depends on what aerial shell you're using again, right? Comes down to different sizes, have different lift charges, different blowouts. It comes down. So anything higher than the regular market sold 3-inch requires special hand. Even 3 inches require special held and care. No smoking. Be careful. Keep electricals away from everything. The sand is essentially to keep the motors and positions in place. And yeah, I'm gonna move on, and I'll get to that. Don't worry. It's coming up on the more slides. I'll keep going with this. So this is a setup example. This is a grid setup. These are the picture you see on the bottom right is the field controller for each individual position. You see how each and every single product is at a different angle. The grids are metal steel grids, which are secured fastly into the ground. They're dug in. They're obviously newer racks, different racks, come down to user preference. These are all pictures from our shows, which we've used in the past. I'm reiterating again, if you see the site, it's clean. There's no garbage. It has to be because fireworks get the sparks from fireworks can ignite garbage immediately. You know, and all of these positions and placements you see are as per our design.
If you guys notice, there was a GI barricade around the entire venue. So kind of nothing moves out, nobody comes in. The GI barricade is also very important.
I'm going to hit that in the next two slides as well, Raghav. This is the indoor effects that you use. Always, like we discussed right in the beginning with the CO2, always regulate your effects. Assess hall height, how many people are in the hall, what's the AC level at, is it consistently blowing fresh air in. We personally do not recommend any smoke emitting pyrotechnic devices indoor, just for the sake of gunpowder. If you use a lot of them, you can choke somebody out. It's not recommended to begin with.
Equipment. There are a lot of questions, Azan, flowing in on what are the actual effects we can use in indoors, either in hotels, ballrooms, and secondly, also in indoor stadiums or large arenas, maybe like Dome or ADOT in Delhi, etc.
So just a short, quick answer and fix for anybody looking at indoor stuff. I would recommend all of you to go and check out Magic FX's website. They do an excellent job in describing each effects, each equipment of that effects, and the effect it actually gives out, if it's suitable for indoor or outdoor. If you look into each particular device, you can read the MSDS, which gives all of that amazing information.
Right. You know, another thing I think we didn't touch upon, unless you're covering it earlier, is the power requirement. Are you covering it ahead, the power requirement?
It's coming.
Excellent. Great. So, guys, all of those, I got a lot of questions for indoor. I hope Azan has answered your question.
Outdoor, obviously, offers a lot of flexibility. Different sizes, like I showed you, have different motors. If you see over here, this is a 6-inch motor. If you see, there's nothing else around it. Look how far the barricading is from everything else. And even the picture you see here, this barge is all set to go in the middle of the ocean, and all the pyrotechnics are installed onto it. And it just comes down to safety. The distances for using of fireworks is imperative. And it's not something that you have a second chance at, because with this line of work, if you mess up, people die. There's no hurt, it's permanent structural damage to a person, which is usually not acceptable. So the main question about safety distances is, what if that particular 6-inch shell decides to burst right there in its motor? Do you have the designated safety distances to protect everybody who's at the event? This is a small chart size by the NFPA, which determines your shell size, your comet size. Comets and mines are usually right here in the under the 1.5 inch mark. This is the feet, the clearance required, 75 for under 1 inch and 105 feet away from product. And these are traditional pyrotechnics. Your 3-inch shells require 210 feet. This is something that everybody should really emphasize on, because a lot of times I've seen that these clearances are not abided by, and they're very risky. Timelines, crew. I think this is what people want, Raghav, they wanted me to get into.
Yes, absolutely. So if you can just talk about, you know, the things which are important to check off, specifically power. You know, many a times we don't know which generator to put it in, or what is the actual supply, what is the actual load. So what do you recommend when there's a large setup or when there's a smaller setup? Obviously, the audio guys won't ever allow to put into their genset because it'll have issues in the audio. We generally end up putting into the lighting of the venue light genset. But what's the typical thumb rule for power here?
So the thumb rule for power, and again, it comes down to which fireworks shooting hardware you're using, what equipment you're using. If you're using traditional bell buttons or with something that has no capacity of regulating the electric circuits going out to your devices, then you should get your own generator, own power supply, and be separate from light, sound, and everything, because the chances of you tripping the actual generator is high if there is no regulated hardware. However, we do not use any house power or any generator power when we do our shows. We are completely self-sufficient. We just need regular house power to charge laptops and computing systems. But for the actual shooting of the show, we do not need any house power. And that's right, simply because we, after loads of experience and bad experience, we have decided that that's just not something. We want to be independent of electricity and power, because that is already a big problem in big events, getting safe power, getting reliable power. And we don't want to contribute to the possibility of trip ups. So we completely have our equipments and our firing machines are self-sufficient to shoot the entire show without any power.
What are the typical permits and licenses which are required, apart from the regular permissions that we take for our events, police permission, etc.?
That's basically it. And if it's a government show, and if it's a big stadium affecting a lot of people, you need NOC from the police. We do a pretty good job with that. Major event companies do a pretty good job with that. But that has to be in place before we execute.
Also, are there any licenses or, you know, kind of work permits that we should check with, check for with our PYRO partners, you know, PYRO company who's executing our work?
There are licenses and stuff like that. by the Indian Explosives Department, but they're just not enforced. In India, I think your best bet is to go with somebody with experience or knowledge or both.
Right. Is DGCA license required? Of course, if it is close to the airport, it would be, but otherwise is DGCA
license? I think if it's close to the airport, in most cases, they don't allow. Because they don't shut the airport down. I mean, in cities like Jodhpur, Udaipur, yeah, because there are no flights in the evening, there are no flights at night. So they
also fly. Talking about safety, a quick question from Fahim. Sorry, I'm running through. We're short on time. Is the debris of fireworks hazardous when it falls?
Yes.
It is, right. So yes. In Udaipur, if somebody is doing it, it's going to fall into the lake. That's a problem, right?
That's the reason why Udaipur shows in the Lake Palace are banned, are no longer available. Because of that, because they don't want to pollute the water. But again, there are new developments, new concepts into that, getting into debris-free shells, getting into self-incinerating shells. That's all manufacturing that is being done in the world, but just not available in India, unfortunately. It's sad, but hopefully we get there. Hopefully we get there because we have tremendous amount of potential. We have great events happening. We just need cooperation from the government and able to lobby these things out.
Great. We can move ahead and close.
So we basically discussed this already, the time code and stuff like that. I also touched a little bit on the different firing systems that are there that are very popular, which are PYRO Digital, Cobra, Galaxus, Fire One. Each of them have their own pros and cons and is based on user preference and interface. I want to kind of show a video. How do I show this video? Is Gaurav, are you going to do this or should I play it from here?
I think play it from your end, and we'll just show a little glimpse of it because we're a little tight on time.
Yeah, 1 second. We'll load this up for a second. Okay. So guys, this is a show that we did in 2014, this was a Guinness World Record by Fireworks by Grucci. I've actually had the honor of working this show. And this summarizes the technology as of today of multiple locations using time code, using one of the recognized firing systems and using all your safety and every precautions in place. Take a look at this video and see how beautifully the entire city is shot at the same time with the capability of time code.
Take last two questions because I think they're very important questions. One, are there any environment-friendly fireworks, aerial shot, or pyros, which don't cause air pollution? Because corporates are getting pretty socially responsible these days, and everyone doesn't want that. So, if you can quickly answer that in 10 seconds.
I have been meaning to talk about this for a while. There are developments of eco-friendly pyrotechnics happening, which use low smoke lifts, no debris, no fallout. All of that exists as of right now. But what we have to come down and work with scientists and geologists and event managers is basically creating carbon footprints of each event that we do. And it's that way it puts the pollution factor at a level which is comprehensible. It's not like you're coming out and talking, oh, you're causing pollution. You're like, okay, no, what is the pollution? What is the carbon footprint of this show? At some cases, we've done case studies where a fireworks show causes less pollution than a person driving 200 kilometers to come to watch that show. The pollution caused by that car is more than the fireworks show. So we need to get with scientists and event managers and with the correct resources in developing carbon footprints, because then we have a solid answer to give to people, to give responsible, and that will basically give responsibility to us as well and execute events in the most environmentally friendly way.
All right, and a quick one from Parikshit. What's the maximum distance between the trigger console to the shot placement without any delay in the fire and trigger?
I'm sorry, come back with that.
What is the maximum distance from the triggering console to the actual fixture without any delay in firing the shot?
You could go up to 15 kilometers.
Okay.
It comes down to your equipment.
Great. So Azan, thank you so much. If you can quickly put up your contact details there, guys, I'm very sorry, but we're running out of time. It's really been an insightful session. I think you all can connect with Azan separately. I think the key takeaway for all of us here is that with great creativity comes great responsibility. And as we work on making our events more exciting and a visual treat, the lives of many are in our hands. Thank you for the session. Thanks for making our events look great. It's been great. You guys can connect with him. And over to you, Sanchali.
Thank you very much, Raghav. Thank you very much, Azan. I'm sure especially the last video left us all in awe. Believing, and Azan would like to quickly ask you this, was this your dream project?
No, in a way, yes. There are a couple of dream projects I'm working on right now as well.
Okay.
That's it. Hopefully.
So I think Azan will be disclosing the details soon in time. But thank you very much, everyone who joined in. There are so many questions. Most of them have been taken. The ones which are not, as we usually do, we will be saving the chat right here and we'll try to address them separately, one-on-one. Thank you once again for joining us here. We will be having our next session at 4 o'clock. Please make sure that you're there with us. These are the EMA Future Ready Leadership Series. And today we will be joined by Tarsem Mittal, who will be talking about artist management. Whether there is a future to it right now, or it has really been hit by what is going on in the world. Thank you once again. This is Sanchali asking you all to stay at home, stay safe. And thank you once again, Raghav, for moderating the session, making it interactive. Thank you to the entire team at EMA who have been working day in and day out to make this possible. And of course, thank you, Tag Labs, for your support.